How does space warfare work? What are the best tactics and strategies? This is a subject I have found difficult to approach without first acknowledging that the answers to these kinds of questions will depend pretty heavily on the alternate reality in which you find yourself. After all, a captain in the Martian Congressional Republic Navy is probably going to be using very different tactics compared to those adventurers trying to find Treasure Planet. And with space warfare in this reality is still woefully underdeveloped, there is really no way to get a sense of what's realistic or practical. But with all that said, I do think there are some space warfare tactics that in most alternate realities just don't make sense. And on this episode of Incoming, I'll break down 5 of them. And because I possess a deep reservoir of courage, I'm going to start with what I suspect might be a controversial choice and immediately turn much of my audience against me. First on my list of terrible tactics is boarding actions. But let me be clear, there is obviously a tremendous advantage to capturing an enemy starship intact, especially if it happens to be full of valuable intelligence. The problem is, the conditions in which a successful boarding action might be carried out are likely to be non-existent during an interstellar war. These kinds of attacks made a lot of sense when opposing vessels were just a literal hop, skip, and a jump away from one another, but as the engagement range of ships increased, boarding actions became harder and harder to accomplish. By the Second World War, they were extraordinarily rare, and only possible in very unusual circumstances, the kind you couldn't really anticipate and plan for. And it wasn't like you had sailors swinging on ropes onto a U-boat, swords in their teeth. It was more just climbing onto a boat that had been prematurely evacuated. In an interstellar war, in which ships might be engaging each other from tens, if not hundreds of thousands of kilometers away, the idea that you'd want to shoot some Marines at an enemy warship and have them cut through the hull and commandeer it seems insane. Even if you had advanced transporters or teleporters that could enable the rapid deployment of Marines to an enemy ship, you would still need to prevent the enemy from scuttling it, as would be standard procedure. Boarding actions would therefore likely be effective only during policing or anti-piracy operations, in which vessels that have already surrendered could be searched for contraband or whatever. Against an enemy starship still capable of defending itself, the chances of success are just too low. If you want to capture an enemy starship, try while it's docked in port somewhere. Next up is the close relative to the boarding action. At number 2, we have ramming. My rationale here is pretty much the same. This was something that made sense when Athens and Sparta were fighting on the Aegean Sea, but has become less reliable as we enter into the modern era, and will likely be pretty much extinct in an interstellar setting. This is a tactic of last resort, an act of desperation, not something you would specifically want to design a starship to accomplish. This is probably because, even with an armored hull, the attacking ship is likely to suffer just as much damage as whatever it's hitting. And I'm no expert in physics, but at the speeds at which any starship is likely to be traveling, a ramming attack is probably just going to disintegrate both ships, assuming they even come into contact in the first place. Space is big, and it has to be pretty difficult to hit even a large target, especially if it's trying to evade you. Third on our list is what I'm going to call gimmick weapons. This is rather broad, but I'm referring to a situation in which you have access to conventional weapons, lasers, phasers, torpedoes, missiles, whatever it might be, but you instead choose to use some new prototype weapon of dubious effectiveness. By way of an example, let's look at the New Republic Starhawk class. It was armed with the usual turbo lasers and ion cannons, but these were secondary to a magnite crystal tractor beam array mounted on the ship's bow. The idea here was that a Starhawk could pull an enemy ship towards it or nudge it into an asteroid or something. This is such a situational weapon and completely reliant on external factors for it to be successful. I just fail to see how this is a better choice than an extra 20 turbo laser batteries. Those can damage the enemy regardless of whether or not there's asteroids around. The Starhawk wasn't the only ship armed with a gimmick weapon though, I'm sure there are plenty of other examples. But moving on to number 4, we have using the environment. Again, I do need to expand on this a bit. Using natural terrain to your advantage, whether on a terrestrial battlefield or in space, is always a good idea. What I object to, though, is when you start relying on the terrain not just as a force multiplier, but as something that will do all your work for you. The classic example of this tactic usually plays out the same way. You've spotted a large enemy fleet. Ah, but look, they have foolishly positioned themselves in orbit of a star, or a nebula, or some sort of interstellar object that is dangerously unstable. We can use this unstable whatever to trigger a massive explosion and wipe out the fleet in one go. This, to me, is a tactic that can really only succeed if a dizzying array of factors all go your way. You need to find a star, or whatever, you can explode, you need to lure an enemy force to precisely where it needs to be, and you have to make sure the enemy isn't aware of the dangerous situation you're putting them in. This is the tactic that Admiral Preston Cole of the UNSC used in the Battle of Psi Serpentis against the Covenant. He fought a fleet action near an unstable gas giant and ignited the hydrogen in its atmosphere, which briefly created a brown dwarf. Even though this did succeed in destroying the Covenant fleet, it's easy to see how it might have gone wrong. Reconnaissance is a critical part of any military operation, and Cole had no guarantee that the Covenant weren't also aware of the unstable gas giant. They might have just as easily turned Cole's own tactic against him. Any tactic that relies on your enemy being completely ignorant of basic military practices usually doesn't play out this well. Last on our list at number 5, we have a tactic that I really don't know how to name. Let's just call it spinning the enemy.
I'll try spinning, that's a good trick.
No, that's not what I'm talking about. I have seen it employed only once during an engagement between the Alliance and the Reavers, and it went like this. Whatever this was, it combines a few of our previous entries into one absurd tactic. It requires closing with the enemy until they are within grappling distance, and then swinging them around until, what exactly, the G-forces kill the crew? Again, how is this preferable to just shooting the enemy? You know, with guns and stuff. The Reavers are supposedly insane, self-mutilating weirdos, and I think this proves it. So if you're not an insane, self-mutilating weirdo, those are the 5 tactics I think you should avoid when fighting your next interstellar war. Or at the very least, don't base your entire strategy on them. But that, of course, is just my opinion. And even though I have a perfect record in my space battles so far, I'd like to hear your thoughts. Are boarding actions a reliable tactic? Are gimmick weapons the way to victory? Are you planning on spinning me around and around until I surrender? Let me know in the comments below. And until next time, this has been Incoming. In Incoming, the Templin Institute discusses the theories and ideas found across alternate worlds. If you've enjoyed this video and would like to join the Templin Institute, consider pledging to our Patreon page. Along with increased security access, you'll be able to vote in polls to determine future topics, get custom wallpaper every week, and receive some other exclusive rewards.